إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، أعاذ الله وإياكم من نار جهنم. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى: ولا تخزني يوم يبعثون، يوم لا ينفع مال ولا بنون إلا من أتى الله بقلب سليم. الله سبحانه وتعالى speaks about his خليل إبراهيم عليه السلام. What is Ibrahim عليه السلام? He says, ولا تخزني يوم يبعثون. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do not disgrace me on يوم القيامة. يوم لا ينفع مال ولا بنون. On this day, no wealth and no children will save a person. إلا من أتى الله بقلب سليم. Except for the one who comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a qalb salim, with a sound heart. Today's khutbah, my dear brothers and sisters, it's about amrad al-qulub, the diseases of the heart. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts. It's been narrated from the hadith of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu, where he says that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions and he says, أَلَا وَأَنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَى إِذَا صَلُحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فسد الجسد كله ألا وهي القلب. My dear brothers and sisters, the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, verily in this piece of body of us, there is a flesh. If this flesh is sound and upright, then the whole body will be sound and upright. And if this flesh is corrupted, then the whole body will be corrupted. ألا وهي القلب. Verily it's the heart. The Messenger of Allah also mentions and he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ جِسَامِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does not look at your bodies. He doesn't look at if you're tall, short, thin, fat, small. Allah doesn't look at your faces. Are you pretty? Are you ugly? وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he looks into your heart, and then he looks into your deeds. Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, when he commented to this hadith, he mentions and he says, وَهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَأْكِيدْ عَلَى السَّعِي فِي صَلَاحِ الْقَلْبِ وَحِمَايَتَهُ مِنَ الْفَسَادِ. Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah said, this hadith, it indicates that a person should strive in rectifying his heart. Should always try to rectify his heart. And he tried to protect it from all these diseases. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't care how you look like. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see what's in your heart. Some people they say, Akhil Kareem, I have a good heart. I have a good heart. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see you do good deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions and He says, قُلْ اِعْمَلُوا فَسَيَرَ اللَّهُ عَمَلَكُمْ وَرَسُولَهُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Do good deeds. For verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see your good deeds. Allah Azza wa Jal, He wants to see you. Allah Azza wa Jal wants to see, are you doing good deeds or are you doing bad deeds? Allah Azza wa Jal wants to see you follow His commands. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to stay away from His, wants you to be staying away from things which He prohibited on you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentions and He says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمُكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَتْقَاكُمْ. Those that are most honored amongst you are those that have taqwa. So all of us are all equal. No one is better than no one, except for the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear brothers and sisters, we'll be talking about the first disease from Amrad al-Qulub. And that's the disease of hasad. That's the disease of jealousy. There was a sahabi, he entered the masjid. And the Prophet ﷺ said, before he entered the masjid, he says, يُطْلَعُ عَلَيْكُمُ الْآنِ رَجُلًا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. Now a person from Jannah will enter upon you. This was the first day. Now this sahabi, he was unknown. This was the first day. The second day, the Messenger ﷺ, he said, يَطْلَعُ عَلَيْكُمُ الْآنِ رَجُلًا مِنْ الْجَنَّةِ. A person from Jannah will come to you. He said it for the second time. The third day, he said, يَطْلَعُ عَلَيْكُمُ الْآنِ رَجُلًا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. That a person from the Jannah will enter upon you now in the masjid. The Sahabi, Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, he wanted to know why this Sahabi, why this companion is in Jannah. So he went to him and he said, I want to spend a couple of nights with you. So he went to the Sahabi and he spent 3 nights with him. When he was with him, he noticed all his ibadah was normal. There was nothing special about his acts of worship. And he was surprised, why this Sahaba is in Jannah? So after 3 days, he said to him, the Prophet ﷺ said that you're in Jannah. What is it that brought you to Jannah? So the man, the Sahabi replied, he says, Allahu A'lam. I don't know why I'm in Jannah. And then Allah barak feekum, what happened afterwards? Abdullah ibn Umar ibn As radiallahu anhu, he walked away. He walked away and he was disappointed. He said, wait, wait, come back. He said, all I know, before I sleep, I don't have any jealousy and no hatred and no grudges in my heart against the believers. This is Allahu Akbar. That's the reason why you're in Jannah. And that's difficult for us. It's difficult for us not to hold any grudges. It's difficult for us not to have any jealousy in our heart towards the believers. Why was it that Iblis was kicked out of Jannah? Because of 2 things. Number one is arrogance, and the second thing is his jealousy. He said, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْ. I am better than Adam عليه السلام. خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ. That you created me from the fire and you created from clay. So the first sin in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was disobeyed with in the heavens was al-hasad. And it was the first sin in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was disobeyed with on earth. Allah azza wa jal speaks about the 2 sons of Adam, Habil and Qabil. Allah says, وَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ ابْنَيْ آدَمَ بِالْحَقِّ إِذْ قَرَّبَا قُرْبَانًا فَتُقُبِّلَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمَا وَلَمْ يُتَقَبَّلَ مِنَ الْآخَرِ قَالَ لَأَقْتُلَنَّكَ قَالَ إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. There was 2 brothers, and both of them were from the children of Adam. One was called Habil, and the other one was called Qabil. They both offered a sacrifice to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal accepted the sacrifice of who? Of Habil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not accept the sacrifice of Qabil. Why? Because Habil gave a better sacrifice to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Habil was more righteous than Qabil. So his brother got jealous of him. He said, I'm going to kill you. He said to him afterwards, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّ اللَّهُ مِنْ مُتَّقِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only accepts from the muttaqeen, from those that fear him. from the righteous, from those that have God consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he killed him, and he was from the people of Nar. He was from Ahl al-Nar. He killed him, why? Because of his jealousy. Why is it that Abu Jahl, he didn't accept Islam? The reason why Abu Jahl didn't accept Islam is because he says one day he was walking with his cousin. And he said, have you accused the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh uncle, have you accused the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he's a liar, no kadhab? قال ويحك, woe to you. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he never told a lie. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never told a lie. He said, why don't you follow him? He said, Yabna Ukhti, O son of my sister. You know Abu Jahl was from Quraysh, as you know. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was from Quraysh. But Abu Jahl was from where? Bani Makhzum. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was from where? Banu Hashim. These two tribes in Jahiliyyah, they were competing with one another. So he said, they fed the Hujjaj, we fed the Hujjaj. They gave water to the Hujjaj, we gave water to the Hujjaj. Until we became part to part, we were very close to one another. They said that a prophet came from Bani Hashim. Where can we get a prophet from? Because of his jealousy, he didn't accept Islam. قَاتَلَ اللَّهُ الْحَسَدْ مَا أَعْدَلَهُ بَدَأَ بِصَاحِبِهِ فَقَتَلَهُ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroy envy. It started with the person that envied and it got him killed. اصْبَرْ عَلَىٰ كَيْدِ الْحَسُودِ فَإِنَّ صَبْرَكَ قَاتِلُ فَالنَّارُ تَأْكُلُ بَعْضُهَا إِمْ لَنْ تَجِدْ مَا تَأْكُلُ. Be patient upon the plot of the envious person, for verily your patience kills him, just like the fire, it eats itself if it doesn't have anything to eat. حَسَدُ الْفَتَى إِذْ لَمْ يَنَالُ سَعْيَهُ فَالْقَوْمُ أَعْدَاءٌ لَهُ وَخُصُومُ كَذِرَاءِ الْحَسْنَى يَقُلْنَ لِوَجْهِهَا حَسَدٌ وَبُغْضٌ إِنَّهُ لَذَمِيمٌ. They envied the boy. Why did they envy the boy? Because they cannot reach his status. And then afterwards, the people became enemies to him. Why? Because he was someone that was much higher than them. He was someone who was much more successful than them. He was someone that was much more successful than them. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المؤمنين من كل دم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد. The second مرض, the second disease that we're going to be talking about is arrogance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purify our hearts and remove from all these diseases. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he described what is kibar, what is arrogance, he says, Al-kibaru batru al-haq wa ghamtu al-nas. That arrogance is that you reject the truth. That when a person comes to you with qala Allah, qala al-rasul, qala al-sahaba, you reject it. Why? Because it goes against your hawa. It goes against your hawa. So you reject the truth, number one. And number two is that you look down upon the people, that you belittle the people. Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah, when he mentions arrogance, he says, when you feel in your heart that you're better than the people. All of us were all equal in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Never ever ever think that you're better than the people. He also said, the Prophet, the one who has a mithqala dharratin, an atom's weight of arrogance in his heart, he will not enter the Jannah. He will not enter the Jannah. So purify this heart from this disease. Never think that you're better than others, regarding how much knowledge you've gained. Even if you become the Sheikhul Islam of the UK, even if you become the richest person, never ever think that you're better than the people. The day that you think that you're better than the people is the day when the marad, the disease, entered your heart. That's why the Prophet Muhammad, what did he say? مَنْ تَوَاضَعَ لِلَّهِ رَفَعَ. that if you humble yourself, Allah Azza wa Jalla will elevate you. Humble yourself and Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will elevate you. We've seen some of our mashayikh, some of our scholars, who are from the most knowledgeable people. One of them is Sheikh Sa'd ibn Nasr al-Shifri, hafidhahullah. The Sheikh, mashallah, is very knowledgeable. It's about to hear kibar ulama. And mashallah, tabarakallah, he comes from one of the wealthiest families in Saudi Arabia. And mashallah, tabarakallah, the most humbling person that I've ever met in my life. So knowledge, wealth, status, all of this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So never ever think that you're better than the people. Never have this disease in your heart. One day, a person was walking next to Malik ibn Dinar, and he was walking in an arrogant way. He was walking in an arrogant way. He said, "Then why are you walking this way?" He said, "Do you know who I am?" The arrogant person said, "Do you know who I am?" So Malik ibn Dinar said, "Yes, I know who you are. You are nothing. You came from a sperm and you go to the toilet." He said, "You are nothing." Then the man said to him, "Now you knew my reality. Now you knew my reality. So humble yourself, the way you walk, the way you talk, and remove this disease. Just because you see someone that's not as rich as you, a lot poorer than you, maybe this person is more closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than you. Maybe this person, if he makes dua, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept his dua. Maybe this person could be a person of Jannah and you could be a person of Nar. Are you guaranteed Jannah?" That's why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he created Jahannam, he said Jahannam is for those people that are mutakaddir. It's for those people that are arrogant. Al-Hasan al-Basri says, what is tawadha? What is humbleness? He says, humbleness is when you leave your house and that you think everybody is better than you. You think everyone is better than you. So always think that the people are better than you. Don't think that you're better than the people. Think all the time that people are better than you. Just because you know you're praying your 5 daily salahs, or you know you're mashallah tabarakallah every on the front line of Fajr, that mashallah tabarakallah you're righteous and everyone else is bad and everyone else is going to go to the hellfire and I'm going to go to Jannah, a'udhu billah. Another disease is the disease of ujub, self-amusement, where you think you're something. You're proud of yourself, you have self-amusement. I'm this, I did this, I am this, I am that. I did this, I memorized the Quran. I went abroad, I did this, I did this, I'm a sheikh, I'm this, I'm rich. Humble yourself. Now inshallah we're going to be talking about how can I remove my heart from all these diseases. We're going to be talking about 10 steps. The first one is, how can I remove my heart from all these diseases, from jealousy, from hatred, from grudge, from all these amrath. Number one is, a person needs to be mukhlas, that he's sincere, that whatever he does it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Say that my life, my sacrifice, and my death is all for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you're mukhlas, that you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all your acts of worship is for Allah azza wa jal. You single out all your acts of worship for Allah Azza wa Jal. You don't do shirk. You don't worship. You don't do ibadah so that people can praise you. In order for your ibadah to be accepted, there has to be two conditions. Number one, it has to be in accordance to the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And number two is, you have to be sincere. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala speaks about the munafiqun. He says, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَهُوَ خَادِعُهُمْ وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قاموا كسالى يراؤون الناس ولا يذكرون الله إلا قليلا. Verily the munafiqun, the hypocrites, they are trying to deceive Allah Azza wa Jal, but Allah is deceiving them. And when they get up for the prayer, they get up in a state of kasal, laziness. يراؤون الناس, that they do to show off to the people. ولا يذكرون الله إلا قليلا, that they don't remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except very little. Point number two. How can I remove my heart from all these diseases? Is that a person is pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you're pleased with the qadr of Allah azza wa jal. Alhamdulillah, you know, don't look at those above you, but look at those beneath you. So you might see, you know, your brother is more successful than you. He has a nice car, has a nice job. his life is going well, and you know, you don't really have a nice car, make dua for him and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his bounty. And be pleased whatever that you have. Alhamdulillah, you have something to eat, you have a place to sleep. There's people in the world that don't have nothing to eat. There's people in the world that don't have no place to sleep. That's number two. Number three is tilawat al-Qur'an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions and he says, Ya ayyuha an-nas, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. All mankind, an advice has come to you from your Lord, and a shifa, and a healing for the breast, and a mercy, and a guidance for the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And we send down from the Qur'an what is a shifa, a healing for the believers, and a mercy. So the Qur'an, we send the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, it's a cure from all the diseases. Also, have a husn al-dhan, have a good thoughts of the Muslim. Why? Because when you have good thoughts of the Muslim, you won't be holding anything in your heart, any grudges. I'll give you an example. A brother calls you. You call a brother, he doesn't pick up. And you say, oh, maybe he's ignoring me. Maybe he doesn't talk to me. And then you have something in your heart, you have a grudge. This is actually su of dhan. Always assume best of the Muslims. There are some people from the Muslimin, they always think bad of the person. When he speaks, he meant this, he meant that. She meant this, she meant that. Oh, he's talking about me. Oh, have husn al-dhan of the Muslims. Make excuses for your brother. When you have husn al-dhan, you yourself are going to feel better about yourself. I'll give you an example. I call my brother, he doesn't pick up. It's not the end of the world. If I sleep and I say, oh, he's ignoring me, he doesn't want to talk to me, I'm only harming myself. But if I say, you know, husn al-dhan, maybe the brother's tired, maybe the brother he won't sleep, maybe the brother's sick, maybe the brother's traveling, maybe something happened to the brother, you will sleep better at night. And also, the Prophet ﷺ, when he came at the masjid, the Sahabas, they saw him, two Sahabas, and they said, and they quickly turned around. He said, wait, ala rizqikum, ala rizqikum, this is Mu'ar Safiyya. He said, oh, Messenger ﷺ, are we going to have any shaykh in you? He said, no, but the shaytan, he runs through the veins of the son of Adam, just like the blood flows. So you also don't do things to make the Muslims have su'ul dhan of you. If someone always sees you, I'll give you an example. If someone always sees you in a gambling shop every single day, outside the gambling shop, what is he going to assume? So don't go to places where there's shubahat, where there's doubts, so that the people can have su'ul dhan of you. So have husn al-dhan on the Muslim. Point number five is advice. Advise one another. The Prophet ﷺ said, Ad-dinu nasiha. Ad-dinu nasiha. So when you advise someone, do it with rifaq, with kindness, with leniency, without shaming the person, without shaming him. Point number six, how can I have a sound heart? Is that you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He purify your hearts from jealousy, from hatred, from grudge, from all these diseases. You make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions and says in the Quran, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't make us have any grudge or anything in our hearts towards the believers. نَظِفُ الْقُلُوبِ, purify your heart. When you hold grudges against people, you're only harming yourself. Wallahi. Someone was bad to you, someone oppressed you, forgive him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. The one who pardons, his word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, خُذُ الْعَفْوَ وَأَمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. Allah says, pardon and turn away from the ignorant. Allah says, the Prophet said, وَمَا زَالَ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا بِعَفْوٍ إِلَّا عِزَّةٍ. That the one that pardons, Allah Azza wa Jal will only increase him in honor. You know, you can take your haqq from him, you know, but don't hold any grudges. Someone oppressed you, took your land, robbed you of your money, forgive him for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. Because if you forgive him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. And make dua that Allah Azza wa Jal, He rectifies your heart. The Prophet says, Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi adinik. O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, keep my heart firm upon your religion. The Prophet also said that the qulub, the hearts are between the two fingers of Ar-Rahman, but of Allah Azza wa Jal. He tosses and He turns how He wants. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify your heart from this. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify it with this. Now, inshallah, I'm going to end with this, bi'idhnillah ta'ala. But before I'm going to end with this, but there's a very important point, my dear brothers and sisters. Your salah. On Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first thing that you'll be questioned about is your salah. If your salah is intact, all your deeds, Allah will look at all your other deeds. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions and He says, مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ. What brought you to the hellfire? They will say, قَالُوا لَكُمْ مِنْ الْمُصَلِّينَ. They will say, we never used to pray. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَأَمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاسْتَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, command your family to pray salah and be patient upon this. Be patient upon this. Command your family to pray salah and be patient upon this. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ. Woe to those who pray. Al-Wail, it's a valley in Jahannam. These people, they prayed their salah. But what? They delayed their salah. They didn't pray their salah. The Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Ahdu alladhi bayna baynahum as-salah. The covenant between us and them, the salah. And whoever left off the salah has disbelieved. The Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he also said, when he was dying, he said, As-salah wa ma malakat aymanukum. The salah. And Umar ibn Khattab, he said, there's no goodness, there's no khair on the one that leaves off the salah. My dear brothers and sisters, regarding how many sins you're doing. If you've done the haram, if you smoked, if you committed zina, always pray your salah. Allah Azza wa Jal, your other sins, Allah can forgive you for it. But leaving off the salah is an act of kufr. I'm not here to make takfir on anybody, but it's very, very, very dangerous. It's very, very dangerous. Allah Azza wa Jal can forgive you for all other sins. But if you die without salah, it's very dangerous. Praying 5 times a day does not make you practicing Muslim. Praying 5 times a day doesn't make you practicing, it makes you a Muslim. It's a must. So command your family to pray and be patient upon this. And if you know someone that's not praying from your relative, advise him with good akhlaq. My brother, my sister, my friend, pray. And make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him. The Prophet ﷺ said, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْوَنَ الْرَاعِيَةِ. Every single one of you is the shepherd, and every shepherd will be responsible for his flock. So it's very important that you give a tarbiyah al-Islamiyah to your children. Allah is just going to ask you, if from now you gave good education to your children, you taught them how to pray the salah, you took them to the masjid, you're a good role model, and then tomorrow they turned out corrupt, you've done your bit. But then you don't teach them salah until they become, you don't take them to the masjid and they become 18, 19. It's too late. You have to start from a young age. Nuh alayhi salam, his son didn't accept Islam. He died as a kafir. Does that mean Nuh alayhi salam, he failed as a father? Kalla. Nuh alayhi salam, he gave the best tarbiyah to his son. But the hidayah of Allah Azza wa Jal, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهِ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You don't guide who you want, but Allah Azza wa Jal guides the one that he was. Nah, Allah guides, but from a young age, take him to the masjid. And you yourself be a good role model. Some fathers, they say, oh, go pray salah, or go to the masjid. And himself is not even praying. He's at home sitting in the sofa. So you yourself have to be a good role model for your child. Take him to the masjid. Teach him Quran. Make sure that he has good friends around him. Because Allah Azza wa Jal is going to question you. Never ever let go of your salah until you die. There's no excuse. Even when you're sick, you pray. You're traveling, you're praying. You always have to pray your salah. The only time the pen will be lifted from you is when you go majnoon, when you go crazy. The one who's crazy, the pen is lifted from him. Even if you're paralyzed, you still pray salah. There is no excuse whatsoever. There's no excuse whatsoever. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا ولن تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكون من الخاسرين سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.